We're in Luke. It is Christmas time. So I want us to ask a question to kind of get us started off. Why do people care so much about celebrities? Why are we obsessed with celebrities? What do you guys think? What are the reasons people care about celebrities and what they think and what they do? There it goes. Yeah. You see their faces everywhere, whether they're skilled. Yeah. They want to be famous, and other people want them to be famous. So they're promoting them, right? Because they make money off that. Yeah. It was interesting, like someone who produces kid shows, a reviewer said, whether it's right or wrong, every single kid wants to be famous. And so we're going to make shows that try and say how a normal kid becomes famous. And like that's how they get people to watch it, because kids like to see themselves. So like all of them dream through our show, right? Like, because they want to be great. And they were quite successful and made a lot of very well-produced kids shows based on this kind of thing. Yeah. Yeah, isn't that interesting? Yeah, because they're miserable. They don't want to be followed all around. Because I don't think I would. So flip it around then. What is true greatness then? People like to think of celebrities as being great. What is true greatness? Some synonyms of true greatness. You don't have to come up with the whole sentence, but like what's a word that describes true greatness? Humility. Yeah. Righteous man. How we know God. Yeah. Selfless. Wise. It's interesting, isn't it? As we go into this Christmas season and we talk about like, you know, there are lots of distractions, right? Some of it's fine. Like, hey, we had a lot of fun. We put up Christmas ornaments and each one has a memory associated with it of where, you know, things that we've been through and done. It's good. But there's so much light and flashing. And the greatest man who ever lived, who was fully God and fully man, same time, he was born in a really humble estate, right? Like he was, and if you think about it, like, man, he redefined everything, but he was born in nothing. And a few years later, he had to flee for his life to a foreign country, came back, lived in obscurity, and then ultimately was killed on a cross, right? And yet God used him to pay for our sins. And he's told we're supposed to follow his example. So it's interesting, as this series, we've talked about like the first kings of Israel and how they're setting things up. And then now we're going to kind of make a switch in Luke to talk about the true king of Israel. And if you haven't already opened your Bibles to Luke chapter 1, let's do so. We're going to be in Luke chapter 1, verse 26 through 38, talking about the promised king is coming, as we see the annunciation, the statement of promise. Here comes the king. Now, let me do a quick review, because I know we all know this story really well. You've heard this a million times, but it's been well said that oftentimes we don't understand our New Testament because we don't understand our Old Testament. Like it's like, you know, being in a party or a Christmas party and you walk into the middle of the conversation and you're just like, wait, what? What are you talking about? Well, because you jumped in the middle of the conversation. Like, and this has been going on for a long time. So quick review, we've seen this before, but the history of Israel, right? God has done a lot from the time of the creation to Adam and Eve to David. And you recall that God has made five major covenants or promises throughout this time. He made the Noahic covenant at the very beginning saying, hey, I created the world. People were sinful then. I destroyed everything. And you know what? They're still sinful. I'm not going to destroy it again that way. And I'm going to bless God's people. I'm going to have a way to save the people. So we find out that that goes through Moses, or sorry, it was Abraham. I'm jumping ahead here. Abraham, who receives this covenant promise that through him, all the nations of the world will be blessed. And he'll have a land, he'll have the seed, he'll have a king come from him. But they are sent to Egypt for 400 years, go through the Exodus and are saved, and they receive the Mosaic covenant, which we talked about repeatedly, how the Mosaic covenant just showed them how bad they were. It goes basically, hey, God saved you, so act like saved people. And how well did they do at that? They failed over and over and over again, like right away. And then you get to the Judges, and it happens continually. And then we picked up in Samuel and 1 Kings, and how we see this promise seems to be specified a little bit more till we get to the Davidic covenant. And in David, we're told that an everlasting kingdom will be set up, that David's family is going to provide this great hope. And we thought perhaps maybe it could be Solomon, because here's where like Solomon seems to bring about Eden almost. But what happened to Solomon and his kingdom? It was sin? We're broken apart. What was Solomon's sin? Idols. Yeah. Did he keep God's laws? Even the clearly specified one. He broke the foundational commandment. And it all fell apart. And so the people go into exile. First, the northern kingdom as it split away, and then the southern kingdom. And in the midst of this, they are promised the new covenant. The new covenant, which states God doesn't just need to give us new rules, nor does he just need to give us a new king. He needs to give us, what was it, Richard? A new heart. And so we need a king who's somehow not just going to give us guidance, but newness. And this is promised. And we see the prophets start talking about this everlasting father, this prince of peace, this king of kings, this suffering servant, right? And this goes all the way back to Genesis. Again, we've seen this before, as you recall this, is the whole story of the Bible is trying to figure out who this promised seed of the woman is. The seed of woman who God told at the very beginning to Eve, he will bite, the serpent will bite his heel, but the seed of the woman, he will crush the serpent's head. Who is going to solve this problem? And the Bible tells us, okay, all right, yeah, so it's coming from Eve. Okay, it's coming from Noah. All right, it's coming from Abraham. It's coming from the tribe of Judah. It's coming from David's family. And it's pointing down, we're like, okay, it's going to be David's family. And David's family messes up, but the prophets still say, no, it's still going to be David's family. Now, we'll get into the history of what happens a little bit in between the covenant, in between the New Testament and the Old Testament, and some of the things introducing Luke, but because it's almost Christmas time, I wanted to just get into this. And so that's why we're starting in verse 26. The other stuff is good, but I'm jumping over it. Just Luke, the book of Luke, chapter 1, verse 26. So we're just going to go straight into that as we see these four ways God's grace is shown on people anticipating Christmas. Four ways that God's grace is going to be shown through this promised king. Now, verses 5 through 25 is really good. It's the story about how John the Baptist is promised. His parents were very old, and in the days before artificial insemination and freezing embryos, did old people have babies? No. And so there was like, it's not going to happen. And the angel Gabriel showed up to Zechariah when he was in the temple and said, you're going to have a miracle baby. And his name is going to be John. And guess what happens? Elizabeth, his wife, gets pregnant. Now, in light of that, actually, the very first verse of 20, verse 26 should actually say, and in the sixth month. But if you put and too many times in English, it looks bad. But actually, verse 26 is saying connection. It's saying in the sixth month of what? Her pregnancy. So we're in the same time. The sixth month is the pregnancy of Elizabeth. And here, verses 26 through 30, we're going to see God shows grace to this unknown woman. God shows grace to an unknown woman who no one should know about. And she is unknown, but favored. Verse 26 through 28. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you." Now, it's interesting because Elizabeth, who the first part starts off, is living in the important area of the Judean countryside where Jerusalem is, where the kings are. And what else? It's not just the kings in Jerusalem. What else is in Jerusalem? The temple. And her husband was in the temple. They are in an important place. Now, look in your Bible. Where is this incident happening? Where is Mary? Nazareth, okay? And it doesn't just say Nazareth, right? It says it's a town in Galilee, right? So why would someone have to say, this is a town in Galilee? You don't have to say Jerusalem is a town in Judea. Everyone knows where Jerusalem is. Why do they have to specify Nazareth? It's so small. Yeah. So this is a picture of Nazareth in the late 1800s. Still pretty small. Kind of stretching out. Modern day Nazareth is home to probably around 60,000 Israeli Arabs. But the thought is in Jesus' day, there was probably only a couple hundred people who lived in Nazareth. It was podunk. It was so unknown, Josephus, the great historian, doesn't even mention it. Nor is it in any rabbinical writings. In fact, we had no record of Nazareth outside of the Bible until 1962. And in 19, because again, people sometimes say, oh, well, it's not really happened. But they found in 1962, and in the town of Caesarea Maritima, right on the ocean, a reference to Nazareth. It was so unknown and so like even bad of a reputation that Nathanael in John 1:46, Nathanael says, "Can anything good come out of where? Nazareth." And Philip's like, "Hey, come and see. Come on. The Messiah came from Nazareth, right?" So she lives in nowhere. Nowheresville. And she's a very young lady, possibly 12, maybe 14. Not really important at this age. Her relative Elizabeth is married to a priest who's serving in the temple of God. But the most important thing, so here she is. This is her relative Elizabeth. Her relative Elizabeth, probably best, like it is translated relative, not necessarily cousin, because it's unclear. The word just means family member. But the most important thing about Mary is that she is betrothed to a descendant of David. So here is her husband, or husband-to-be, I'm sorry, Joseph. And David is way back over here, which means there are a lot of other descendants of David too. This isn't necessarily special. And is he living in Jerusalem, close to being king? No, there isn't. There isn't even a king of David on the throne. Who's on the throne right now? Herod the Great, right? He's not even Jewish. So Joseph is like, oh, well, she's the child of David, or he's the son of David, but like that means nothing at this point. And we know that betrothal was the first part of the marriage process. Basically, a man or his family would give the bride's family a expensive price, a engagement gift. In Genesis 34, verse 12, he said, "Ask for me a great bride price and a gift you as you will, and I will give you whatever you say. Only give me the young woman to be my wife." Deuteronomy 22, 29 says that the bride price was 50 shekels of silver. Most people made about like, you know, I think they said like 25 shekels a year. So it was like at least two, maybe, you know, 3 or 4 years wages to marry a young lady. Jews in the 17th, 18th century kind of continued this practice with expensive engagement rings. It came from somewhere, it came from the Jews, but they wouldn't give it to the woman. It would go to her family as a symbol of a gift of, here, I will, you know, take care of this woman for you. So, yeah. He was a descendant from David. Yes, Joseph was. We'll come back to that. But actually, it doesn't say that right now. It just says Joseph is the descendant of David. Yeah. Oops. Yeah, I know. It just jumped too far. Yep. So you see the follow the blue lines up through. The blue is the men, so the blue one, Joseph, is connected to David through the lineage. Mary, being the pink one, marries into that lineage. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And so you see, so the rabbinic practice today, and basically since at least the second, third century, was to trace the lineage through the mother, because you could clearly say this baby came from this woman, therefore it's actually her child. And I think there was some thinking that the woman would have more of a nurturing of the theology. But in the Bible, it says son of the man. So in the Bible, it's always paternal. It's the fatherly relationship that they track. No, we'll come back to that, because I think, yeah, that's an excellent point, because he's not, but he does become his adoptive father. And in Jewish tradition, if a child is born to you when you are married, even if he is not biologically your child, he is your child. It kind of took away some of those who cares for the child issues happened. So, yes. Yeah, he's made equal. He's made equal. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was a big practice. Yeah. Mhm. And we'll come back to that, because when we get to chapter 3, it has a long lineage it goes on. So we'll have to explain what that lineage means and how that works. So betrothal, they're engaged. Are they living together yet? No. For long time, so betrothal is basically a contractual agreement. They say, we're going to get married. Money is transferred. Promises are made, but they're not yet married. So because of that, the Bible calls her a virgin betrothed. Now, does anyone remember how important was motherhood in Israel? Very important. Why was it very important? Yeah. And that just necessity even, right? Like the children were your savings, were your retirement plan. Yeah. And to bring us back to what we saw earlier, theologically, there was a nature too. Is remember, the whole purpose of redemption was saying, we got to find the seed of woman. And so every birth to an Israelite was a, could I have the Messiah? Could the Messiah be coming? And you know, again, not maybe once time went on, they're like, okay, well, I'm not the tribe of Judah, so it's not me. But there was still the sense of like, well, but like, maybe like this is important. God's promise comes and continues with every generation being born was another opportunity for God's promise to come true. It was huge. But is Mary a mother yet? No. So again, in Jewish circles, she's no one. Like I know today sometimes youth gets lifted up, and in those days, if you were young, you were worthless. You got to do something with your life. And so the angel shows up to this woman in Podunkville who's pretty unknown, who has nothing significant about her. And what does the angel say to her? What was that? Yeah, so we're going to not be afraid. The greeting is the word Cairo. Favored one is the word carito. Basically, it's she saying, grace greeting given to the grace given one. And Roman Catholics like to twist this passage to say, oh, she was so great. But that makes no sense of her location, the narrative, or her response. She doesn't go and say, ah, yes. I deserve this. I am a very righteous woman. I'm so glad God finally noticed, right? She's shocked because she's not deserving. So why is grace not a gift if it's deserved? I mean, why is grace not a gift if it's deserved? Yeah, it's obligation. It's due. Remember, like, Romans 6 says the wages of sin is death. What you deserve is death, but the free gift of God in Christ Jesus is eternal life, right? So that's the issue there. And her response is then shown, as Victor was bringing out, in fear. She's just like, what? This fearful but grace-filled woman. Verse 29, she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. So she's concerned. Now, the word means she's greatly confused. Greatly confused. Probably fear is implied. And it's the idea of she's struggling to figure it out. Why do you think, why might she be afraid and struggle when she sees this angel show up in front of her? Yeah. 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 So an angel, like people fall as if they're dead when they see angels, right? It's a big deal. But again, look down in verse 29. and she tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. What about the greeting especially draws her attention? Yeah. So why might she be like trying to figure out what "oh favored one" means? She doesn't feel okay, yeah. 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 Or. Yeah. And greet you. And notice the phrase there. The ain't it. Because it says, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." And in verse 30, angel says, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." Isn't it interesting? She found favor. It was not like favor was out there and favor found her. Like God was looking for someone worthy enough. And the angel's like, "Oh, yes, I found someone finally worthy enough for God's blessing." No, she has found favor. God grants it. It's very interesting. An ancient tradition says that this is the spot where she met the angel in this cave. I don't know, it might be true, it might not, but people have always tried to point to the places in Nazareth where the there's a church there now called the Church of the Annunciation. And so there's a tradition there, but you can just imagine, look at this little woman, young lady, really, barely more than a child. Shows up an angel. An angel says, "God has favor on you. Don't be afraid." God uses the weak and insignificant to show his greatness throughout. Hudson Taylor wrote in 1898, "Go forward in the strength of the Lord and in the sufficiency that comes from him alone. Thank him for your conscience insufficiency, for when you are weak, then he can be strong in you." It's interesting. So I want you guys to think again. Little Mary receives the angel's presence. And God, through Paul, said that when you are weak, he is strong. What should we think about our weaknesses? They're what? They're strengths to God. Why are they strengths to God? Ah, it shows that you need God. I know, they often do, don't they? Especially in ancient artwork. They're like, "That angel looks way too feminine." Artistic thing. So then flip side is, what should we think about the weaknesses of others? I don't know about you, I'm often tempted to get frustrated with the weaknesses of others. Like, "Why can't you figure this out, person?" And yet that doesn't seem to be what God does throughout. What should we think about the weaknesses of others? What? Extend grace? How so? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Accept that they're weak. Mm-hmm. I think perhaps even more than accept that they're weak, is we can see their weakness as an opportunity for God's power to shine through. Maybe it's going to shine through us as we help them and encourage them, or maybe it'll shine through them, right? Like, God uses weak things. I think weakness in this case would be, because Mary is a righteous woman, but she is a powerless woman, an insignificant woman. So I think it would probably be more that. It's more the weakness side of things, the fact that she's not strong enough to make a name for herself. And God's grace is sufficient in our weaknesses. But in... Well, that's not what he says, though. So, yeah. Oh, and she will show that. I don't think we'll get there. She's weak in the sense that she is not significant in the world. She has no power to change the world, and yet God uses her to change the world. Yeah. She's insignificant, and yet God makes her very significant. Yeah, her own circumstances, yeah. And she gets put into a very powerless situation. We'll get there. And how she responds to that is amazing. And it's a great example to us. So verses 31 through 33 shows how God sends the promised one. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you should call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High. And the Lord will give him the throne of his father, David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom, there will be no end. Verse 31 talks about the Savior, the Annunciation, as it's called. It's a fancy word meaning an announcement of something amazing. And she's going to conceive a child, which is interesting how the Bible makes a distinction between conceive and bear, showing that the Bible does make an understanding that a child exists before he is born, which has implications on the whole abortion issue. But there's always this understanding in the Bible that children are there. This is a picture of a woman of Nazareth around 1900 with a child. Women have been giving birth since God created. But this one would be different. This one would be miraculous. And this miraculous fulfillment would come from Isaiah 7:14, the promise, the Lord will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now, just like John, God gives the name and he says, Jesus. Interesting, because this is Jesus, not Emmanuel. But is Jesus a very special name? No. Does anyone know what Jesus is the Hebrew equivalent of? What? Joshua. Yeah. So this is a grave box from around the first century that has the name of Jesus on it. Actually, it says, I forget exactly what it is, but it's the son of Jesus. It's Bar Jesus. It's like something son of Jesus. And there were a lot of people named Jesus at the time, but the name means God saves. Yahweh saves. And so a lot of people are like, this is a great name. I want to name my kid Yahweh saves. So a lot of people were named Jesus. But there was more to it than just that, because look at verse 47. As Mary sings this great praise psalm, in 47, she says she needs something. What does she need? My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. What does Mary need? A Savior, right? She understands that this Jesus is going to be part of God's promise. And he's not just a savior, he's also the great son of God. Verse 32, he will be great and will be called the son of the most high. Turn, if you could, back to verse 15 of chapter 1. Talking about the promise of John the Baptist, the angel says, for he will be great before the Lord. How is John great, does it say? What's the relationship of his greatness? From the Holy Spirit, he's going to be full of the Holy Spirit before, before he's born. And notice he's great before the Lord. As he stands before the Lord and God uses him, he will be great. But notice, what's the definition of Jesus? Is Jesus great before the Lord? Yeah, he's the Son, and he is just great. But would Jesus be seen as great for many years? Nope. We already said, he's pretty anonymous, fleeing from his homeland, working as a carpenter, being unknown for many years. But he is the Son of God. We'll come back, talk about the Trinity and how this meaning is made clearer as we go along. But he's special. That's the promise. And not just this, he is the fulfillment of the Davidic promise. There's a statue of David that's in Jerusalem. But we remember, we read in 2 Samuel 7, verse 16, Yahweh said to David, your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. The prophets pick up on this and start saying that, this forever throne is going to come with the Messiah, and he is going to rescue his people. And it looked for a while that Solomon's failure and all the king's failure had wrecked it horribly. But now an angel is saying, here is the one. This is the one you've been waiting for. This is the one who's going to fulfill God's promise. And there's a riddle that exists that Jesus answers in Luke 20. Of how can the Messiah be David's son and also David's Lord? And that'll come back to this idea of he's the Son of God. What does that mean? Now, this is a very helpful and good reminder, because this shows that God is a promise-keeping God. And we need evidence sometimes, because our emotions are very tricky things, right? How often does it feel like something's never going to happen, right? Even if you think if someone tries to promise you something, they're going to be there for you, but there's a delay, and all the thoughts start to swirl. The doubts in your mind come about. You're like, oh no, they've forgotten. They're never going to do it. But if you know the person keeps their promises and has kept their promises every single time, their character shines through. And you're like, I can trust them. They've never let me down before. And I think, again, that's the history of this long history leading up to Jesus' announcement. It's not just a good Christmas story. It's an answer to millennia of longing, millennia of going, God's going to make a promise, and God clarifies his promise and clarifies until people go, oh, this is the one. Now, for the sake of time, I'm just going to skip some little discussion here and go to verse 34 and see how God grants faith to the faithful woman. Because not surprisingly, Mary has a question. It's like, oh, great. How will this be since I am a virgin? I like the King James. Sometimes the King James gets it very literally, or it says that the Mary said unto the angel, how shall this be since I know not a man? I'd never known a man. That's the way that the Greek uses it, to know in an intimate sense. And it's a perfectly reasonable question, right? Anyone who says that the virgin birth was a common idea that Christianity stole from Egyptian stories is nuts, because people, like if you do the research, it's very different. This idea of a virgin birth has been replicated ever since Christianity and since Jesus. But before then, it was just like, this was an unknown concept. This didn't happen. Roman Catholics try and spin this and say, she's like, oh, I've resolved never to know a man. But that doesn't come from the text. Like, you cannot translate that. Now, is she rebuked for this question? Does the angel say, how dare you question God? No. The Bible's full of people asking questions to God. In Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2, the prophet cries out, oh, Yahweh, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear? God, you're not listening to me. And he's not rebuked for that. Job's questioning becomes a problem because he starts to actually make accusations against God. But God's a big God. He can take our questions. He can take our moments where we're like, this doesn't make sense, God. We got to search for answers. Habakkuk shows that. Habakkuk 2, verse 1, he says, I will stand on my guard post and I will station myself on the rampart. I will keep watch to see what God will speak to me and how I may reply when I'm reproved. I'm going to look for answers, but I'm going to wait for God to correct me. That's the righteous answer. And even, I think we don't have that clearly stated in Mary, but it's a long tradition of her saying, like, hey, Lord, this doesn't make sense, but you tell me. And the answer, of course, is in the power of God. Verse 33 through 35. I'm sorry, verse 35 and 36. The angels answered her, oh, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. Again, different. The power of God overshadows. Now, you remember in the temple, right? What happened to the priests when the power of God, the Holy Spirit, descended into the temple? They had to run out. And this happens again and again. Like, Jesus is on the Mount of Transfiguration, and it says that a cloud fills, overshadows them. The same word is used, and they hear God say, this is my beloved Son. Like, this is a powerful force. God's power makes things possible. And God is so good. He doesn't just say, I'm powerful, trust me. He's like, let me give you some proof. Verse 36. Behold, your relative Elizabeth is in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who is called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God. You want proof? Your relative Elizabeth over in Judah. This is a picture of the mountain area where people believed that Elizabeth and Zechariah lived. And the whole history of Israel is a story of God using barren women, to make a large nation. Sarah was barren. Rachel was barren. God controls the womb. And he is doing something amazing now. And so how does Mary respond then? Bless you. In verse 38, we see her submission. Mary said, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. Before Paul calls himself the slave of God in Romans 1, the word here for servant is doulos, which should be translated slave. She already understood. She's already doing it. She's like, I am God's slave. She understood God was king, and as his people, she was supposed to submit to him. Jesus says later in Luke 17, we'll get there, like that the servant, the slave, when he's done all that he should do, does the master thank the servant because he does what is commanded? It's like, no, so you also, when you have done all you were commanded, you say, we are unworthy slaves. We have only done what was our duty? Put yourself in Mary's shoes. We'll try and wrap up with this thought. Why would that be a tough thing to submit to? What are some of the challenges Mary would have to face submitting to God's plan? What, morning sickness? Yeah, just pregnancy, normal pregnancy issues. But society, what? Yeah. 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 Because if you're not married and you didn't come become pregnant with your soon-to-be husband, he knows that, well, what's the logical option here? She did something wrong. She was a sinner, which we see that's what Joseph thinks of, right? In Matthew 1:19, her husband Joseph, being a just man, unwilling to put her shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. He didn't believe her. What was the penalty for adultery? Death, stoned to death, right? And we can tell this story got out. People weren't ignorant of this story. Even when Jesus returns to Nazareth and he starts teaching in the synagogues there. In Mark 6, verse 3, the people say, is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary? It's interesting, Mark 6, 3, they don't call him the son of Joseph, as was often the case. You see that, like, it's always, you know, for example, it's like, it's Peter bar Jonah, Peter, the son of Jonah. They don't say Jesus, the son of Joseph. They say Jesus, the son of Mary, because they know the story has gotten out. He's not Joseph's son. Everyone in that, small town, everyone knows. Think about that. Especially every time we get to Christmas, Mary is, a young lady, she's not stupid. She knows what the culture is. She's lived in this small town her whole life. She knows the rumor mill goes around and she knows what will happen. And yet how does she respond when the Lord says, this is what I'm doing? Go a little bit further. And she's the Lord's servant. And go to verse 48. The master has looked on me in the humble estate of his servant, for behold, from now all generations will call me what? Blessed. The faith that that took. Think about the faith that that took. The strength that that took, to go back to what you're saying, the strength it took to believe. The future is going to call me blessed, when probably all her contemporaries were calling her cursed. I love this quote from James Montgomery Boyce. He said, there's a paradox. Of course, as Augustine, Luther, Edwards, and Pascal and others have pointed out, when individuals rebel against God, they do not achieve freedom. They fall into bondage because rebellion is sin and sin is a tyrant. On the other hand, when men and women submit to God, becoming his slaves, they become truly free. They achieve the ability fully to become the special, unique beings that God created them to be. That's what Mary shows us. She says, I am God's slave and I submit. So how can we then have this attitude of submission to God's will, even when it's hard? We say, I have to submit. Pray for the strength to submit. Let me add a part to this then. What makes it hard to totally submit? My will. Yeah. Because it's not what I want. This isn't what I want, God. But what makes it worth it to submit to God? his blessings. What are his blessings? Peace, wisdom. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And yet we know on the other side of suffering. Yeah. Yeah. And because on the other side of suffering is the greatest joy, is being, James says, perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. I think what's so amazing about Mary, and this is one thing as we dig into this, is she is a very biblically minded woman. Mary doesn't do this because she just, it's like, all right, I'm naive, I'm just going to walk into it. No, her words that flow out, especially in the Magnificat right here, is saturated with scripture. She studied her Bible well. And so when this great moment of testing came, she said, yes, Lord, I know you. I trust you because I've known you my whole life. And I said, like, the one way we do is we need to know God's promises. And how could she say no to God fulfilling his greatest promise to save the whole world? And she got to be part of it. Yeah. 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 Or maybe he gave her that heart. He gave her the heart to be so submissive. I think that's one thing we really, as we walk into the Christmas season, we really have to see in Mary a model of someone who received God's grace and responded with a submissive attitude. And it's a good reminder for many of us, Christmas isn't always the joyful celebration that we expect it to be. And yet the joy is God is working something good and we can submit to him because he's keeping his promises. He has in the past, he will again. Any just last thoughts or questions on the passage? Magnificat. It's the Latin word for magnificent. So if you look in the verses 46 through 55 is often called Mary's Magnificat. Yeah. It's the magnificent song of Mary. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, I'm not big for Latin. It's not my thing. My wife loves singing Latin. She thinks it's such a beautiful language. I'm like, but I do like that one. I think that's cool. To some degree, I haven't quite decided what we'll do next week because next week is the White Elephant Gift Exchange on Friday. And so if you guys can't make both, I'd encourage you to come out on Friday to, I know. And then Christmas is the week after that. Like, it's crazy. So we might do a shorter, but just dig into it a little bit next week. But I don't want to burden people with two times. I would encourage you to come out on Friday, but we'll still meet next week. So. Okay, I'm like, what am I doing wrong? Yes, we could try and just get one of my mistakes in there. Let me pray. God in heaven, Lord, make us trophies of your grace. Like Mary, we are so often weak and powerless in our world, and yet you show up in many ways, or whether it's a miraculous incident where, Lord, something happens and we're like, this is crazy, God. How did this happen? Or whether it's, you know, a powerful incident when your word speaks to us, or whether it's just you taking away something and bringing a trial into our life. May we, along with Mary, say, we submit. We are your servants. May we believe that great joy will be found there, that we will be seen as blessed in the future. Lord, allow us to trust you. May we remember, Lord, that just as you were good to Mary and how much we are excited for what she was used to accomplish, so, Lord, we will see our stories come out the same way. We ask, Lord, that we might